effect is to carry through on the previous talk.
And this one.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Schulz, for including me in this session. And I'm so glad that there are a good number of people in the audience, because this is a kind of a futuristic therapy or a futuristic aspect of ophthalmology. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the genetics of corneal dystrophies. Basically, why do we need to study genetics? There are advances in ocular research, and as the previous speakers had showed before me, we may be moving in a direction for perhaps interventional strategies. Dr. Schulz did raise some concerns about a lot of fiddling with genes. We don't want to fiddle with nature too much. So we're looking at therapies which could be targeted and ideally in the eye rather than, you know, playing with the embryo. And from the aspect of nation building as a country, we have a very vast array of expertise, a lot of talent, basic as well as clinical. So India is well positioned to try to take this knowledge forward. Molecular genetics is one of the areas that we need to focus on. It is expensive, but it is something that people who have the means should invest in. And when you're looking at interventional strategies, of course, one will have to keep a holistic approach and a multidisciplinary team. So it's important to you know, make the network and connect with people who are good and who are experts in their area. Now, molecular genetics, there are various global initiatives, as Dr. Prakash had mentioned. And as I said, we need an interplay of clinical, basic, and operational factors. And whenever we're talking about genetics, one mustn't forget that there's always an ethical issue involved. You have to see that whatever you're doing, how much are you disturbing nature, or what is the inherent biological makeup of you know, human beings? And there is a concept of conflict of interest. So we may be interested in a research paper, we may be interested in getting a big name in research, but the patient may not have the same view. For example, there may be episodes where one is asking the patient to pay for the test because you want the data, and that's something that you know, it's a question of how you put it to the patient, whether they should have that test or not. So one has to be always conscious of this, because finances are involved and resources are limited. So basic, clinical, and applied, and there is also the scope for functional analysis, and for that bioengineering gives you a very good model where you can do the study in vitro and test out your hypothesis. So when we're talking about studies, we're looking at, with the knowledge of genetics, we also need to be conscious that we need to get this information out to the public. Like, we keep talking about autosomal recessive disease, we keep talking about the problems of consanguinity, but we're not sharing this information with the public. So one needs to, you know, consider whether consanguinity, if there is evidence to suggest that consanguinity is harmful for particular disorders, then I think we should share it with those communities. So this is something that we need to keep in mind. Now, so thinking all of this, we often have patients coming with low vision, and we're always focusing on a particular aspect. We decided that let's look at something differently, whether we can have put people together and see if in future we can prevent these diseases or give some more practical information to the public about what should be done, and also direct our research with the help of the knowledge that our basic scientists had. So we had a brainstorming. We had a host of people from all over India, and clinicians as well as basic scientists. And we were told that there is no limit to what you can study. There's a vast array of disorders. And where should you start? So we were told that you target the single gene disorders. And as clinicians, we were able to tell the basic scientists as to what we feel are the clinically important disorders. Like, for example, you may have a disease, but it's not that difficult to treat. Whereas another disease is actually quite quite difficult to treat. So we will give them the clinical priority and they will give us the genetic priority. So we thought that it is so good in India, that is, it is a study of genetics of ocular disorders in India. And since then, many platforms have developed. There's a Global Eye Genetics Consortium, and we share ideas. We also get a feeling by such meetings to know what the rest of the world is doing, because a lot of the information is not really out in the papers yet. It's in people's labs, it's people, and we know we don't get a chance to share information face to face that often because it's not very affordable to keep going for all the meetings. So these kind of platforms are useful. And when we talk about eye genetics, now, at the moment, I'm going to focus on the cornea. So which disorders of the cornea need we to invest in? So from our discussion, we felt that congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy is important because there is a unique population in India. For some reason, CHED is not seen that rampantly or extensively all over the world, and it's not totally a question of population. Naturally, here with a large population, any disorder will have more numbers. But if you see proportionate to the actual number of cases, somehow CHED is more in India. So we felt that, yes, we need to look at that. And then, of course, a lot of advances have been made in the classification of corneal dystrophies. There's the IC3D classification, and it's helped people to understand that something that we used to take so simple, that this is a simple classification, epithelial, stromal, and so on, when people put their heads together, they found that there were problems. And earlier, the knowledge was based totally on the clinical information. But then, as the genetic information and the histopath information was put together, people realized that there's a lot of variety. You may have the same gene, the same disorder, but it's manifesting differently. Or you have different, so you may have different phenotypic manifestations. And what was originally thought to be isolated to one particular layer, it has now been found that actually it does affect various layers. So therefore, the IC3D classification, if you look at it, category one are the disorders where the genetic locus is known, the gene is also known. But I would like to focus on this third point. The features are well defined. And I'll talk a little bit about this later on. And examples around here are CHED2. So earlier, we used to consider CHED1 and CHED2. This is the whole list of the dystrophies, which have now been simplified as epithelial, subepithelial, epithelial, stromal, stromal, and endothelial. Here, I'd like to point out that they still put macular dystrophy under stromal, but we do know as clinicians that the macular dystrophy does affect the endothelium as well as the epithelium. And I would like to understand from the people who made this classification why they left that out for macular dystrophies. Now, coming to CHED, if you remember, I had said that there is a clinical typical feature. So this is what we have: corneal clouding, blurred vision, and nystagmus. And then these are the signs: the ground glass haze, the bluish appearance of the cornea, increased corneal thickness, and then secondary changes may come along later on, such as BSK and spheroidal degeneration. And this is the autosomal recessive variety. We know the chromosome, we know the gene, we know how the gene produces its effect, and what is the loss of the function. Now, question is, can we really cure this by doing a gene therapy? And it is seeming a little unlikely because it happens very early on in utero. So that may not be the right approach. And when we talk about CHED1 and CHED2, I just want to highlight that though we know that CHED2, which is the autosomal recessive form, does manifest very early, but we've had clinically a few patients who actually manifested quite late. So there is some kind of a variation. And again, I'd like to highlight, so we do have a differential diagnosis of congenital glaucoma, metabolic disorders, PETERS, congenital infections, PPCD, and forceps injury. Now, here to give you an example of CHED, where we, this kind of a patient, if you see, you wouldn't straight off think that it is an example of CHED, but this was an older patient who turned out to be CHED on histopathology as well as on the gene testing. So it's not as simple as the table or the illustration shows. So we have some experience of our own congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy. It was a prospective cohort, and we found a mutation spectrum for the first time in North India. And this was similar to what had been found in South India with some variations. We have a study from the group in Hyderabad as well as Arvind. So where does this take us? So basically, it shows that There are variations in India itself. There are variations in a little bit of, you can call it ethnic variations or the genetic makeup variations. And I just like to give an illustration of a patient of a 60-year-old girl who was brought by her father. She had whitish opacity in both eyes with a large size of eyeballs, involuntary eye movements, no history of watering, redness and photophobia, and no history of trauma. Family history, she was the only one involved and it was a non-consanguineous marriage. And on examination, the cornea had a large diameter, both eyes, there was an stretching of the limbus, typical things that you would expect with a congenital glaucoma, but there were certain unusual features as well. So there was a lack of the typical glaucoma triad, for example, and the parents were quite caring. They were quite clear that right from the beginning, they did not have that typical triad. The visual acuity was that she followed objects, she was taken up for keratoplasty. We screened again using IOCT to see if there's any evidence of anterior segment dysgenesis or aniridia, and it was not. The anterior chamber was quite good. You can see the lens was formed in a nice angle. And the patient underwent surgery. The pressure was high. She'd already had the trabeculectomy and trabeculotomy done in both the eyes. And so therefore, we were left at whether it was primary congenital glaucoma with leukomatous corneal opacity or anterior segment dysgenesis with secondary glaucoma. And just kept it in mind that could it actually be congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy. Her histopathology, however, ruled it out. There were no abnormality of the desmids and the endothelial cells were present. So basically when you have a child like this, you have various disorders that you think of, but there is a bit of an overlap and you actually see the clinical features. So my submission here is that we need the cornea specialist and the glaucoma specialist to perhaps start collecting their information. And because we normally just take it for granted that this is it and we proceed with the surgery, we don't take that much care to note down each clinical feature because there may be an overlap. And then there is this paper of coexistent congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy and congenital glaucoma, retrospective evaluation. They were diagnosed as glaucoma, they underwent keratoplasty, and it was a histopathology which suggested that it was CHED. Now, whether those changes were secondary to the raised IOP, that we cannot say, but we would require genetics to prove it. And as I explained before, it's a little bit expensive. It may not always be easy. And similarly, we have mesodermal degenesis, and there's a nice paper by Ken Nischel, which shares how the genetics of congenital corneal opacity does impact the diagnosis and treatment. And this is the group of disorders that we're talking about. And I showed with my illustrative case that clinically, sometimes you really are not sure. So we need to combine all this information better. And maybe we can have a consortium and people can contribute their information so that we have a better understanding for this disorder in our country. Thank you. I'd like to recognize all the residents and faculty, as well as Dr. Arundhati Sharma, who does the genetic work, molecular genetics work for us.
Thank you very much. We're in a little time crunch now, but now it takes my pleasure. It is my pleasure.